Between 1992 and 1996, I lived in a rent-controlled apartment in Harvard Square, Massachusetts, which is an intersection of multiple streets and is actually less a square than a pedestrian area with a train station and a bunch of cars flying through it. It was a charming little area that over time, like a lot of similar areas, became less charming. But there was one moment in it that I really look back to now with completely different eyes, and that was the Cybersmith. This is Jason Scott Talks His Way Out of It, a podcast about technology, history, and getting myself out of debt. Thanks to William Hearn, Daniel Boyd, and the hundreds of other supporters on Patreon and elsewhere who have been supporting me and helping me get out of debt. I'll try to avoid making this too much about Boston institutions, but there were a chain of bookstores in the New England area called the Paperback Booksmith, and this was a classic example of a mall bookstore. Mall bookstores are pretty much gone now, but at a time when malls were ruling the landscape, Paperback Booksmith was a dependable location for getting your hands on all of the standard mass-market paperbacks that you would want to buy. There's an entire class of books that come through the Internet Archive's collections that I just simply call mall bookstore books. It was a standard set of a couple thousand titles that were always for sale. Joy of Cooking, or 101 Uses for a Dead Cat, or all of the Mad Magazine and Garfield and Snoopy, along with calendars, self-help books, versions of the Bible, versions of The Lord of the Rings, and so on. It was like having a kind of standardized Western canon of the shopping mall. If a mall had a Radio Shack, a Sears, a Chess King, a Piercing Pagoda, an Orange Julius, you could be assured it was probably going to have a Paperback Booksmith. In Boston, there was a Brookline Booksmith, and apparently the family that was behind the Paperback Booksmith chain. And one day, I became aware that a new chain was going to open up, and it was going to be called the Cybersmith. So let's go back to the mid-1990s. We've already gone through the phase of the home computer and the home video game system being a required part of a modern home. You have to have the ability to play games, and you have to have the ability to do some sort of computer work. Cell phones are not yet smart enough to become computers on their own and turn every single person into an individual computer center. You have instead a variety of second and third generation home computers. You have phone lines that can transfer data at pretty good rates, but not excellent ones. And yet there are also all of these advances coming out in terms of computing power, graphics, and the ability to search for information that are not quite ready to go to the home. This is where we get the concept of the last mile, that the hardest part of all networking isn't really getting it all through all of these networks, but that last mile to a home is always going to be lagging behind in terms of technology. I don't know how much longer that concept is going to last, but back in the mid-90s, it was there. You went from being on the greatest space tube in the world to a dirt road just before it got to a house or an apartment. In this open area, there was thought to be opportunity. The idea that computing technology that was becoming more and more powerful, yet very hard to sell to individuals, could be put in centralized hubs around a city, and people would come and visit and interact with that technology and speed, that beautiful online world, for a fee. Now, obviously, this concept is still around. We have cyber cafes, we have gaming lounges, we have LAN events. People do still assemble in centralized areas and to various degrees of being out in the open or being into small rooms and cubicles. They pay a fee and they're able to use superior technology that they themselves don't have to keep in their home. But in the case of the Cybersmith, as I read it in newspaper articles of the time, one of the younger generations of this family had convinced the patriarch that it was a good idea to set up a business, that the paperback Booksmith was not going to be the future, that there was something else that was coming down the line, and it was worth the money to stake a claim now and get on the ground floor. And as luck would have it, it was going to be a relatively short walk for me over to this new Cybersmith. Here are my memories. Harvard Square had a very interesting set of buildings through all of the years, since it had been there for literally centuries. The buildings that housed all different sorts of businesses, they kind of collapsed in on one another. They had that sort of strange rabbit warren feel that you might not get in other locations. There were no grid patterns to work with. You would go into some sort of interesting entrance and then either go up and down some stairs, find a set of businesses, and then take a turn and find even more. Some of them would be somebody's office, and then you would find a weird bookstore or a t-shirt place or a pizza parlor, and it would continue that way all the way through to another street. And I love the idea of little mazes of commerce and exploration where you turn a corner and there's something there you didn't know this building had, and you walk inside and you feel like you're the only person to have discovered it. There's no outside light, it's all artificial, and you have somebody back there who sees a few people every once in a while. So there's a real sense, like I said, of discovery. It was in one of these buildings that Cybersmith took over the second floor. You found the entrance to the Cybersmith at street level, and you would walk through a lobby that had a slight feel of being the opening exhibit in a museum. And then you would either get in an elevator or go up a staircase, and you would find yourself at Cybersmith. No expense had been spared with the Cybersmith. When you walked in, you could tell that there was nothing like this around. It's perhaps really easy to forget how different things were before Apple stores became the gold standard for technology. Most stores tended to use maximum floor space. The Cybersmith wasn't designed that way. It had the attributes of a store. It had a front desk, it had counters, and it had products. But it also was beautifully created. The furniture that you sat in to use computers was custom designed. The bar that served drinks and sodas looked as good as any luxury restaurant. And there were posters and images on the wall of all of this perceived future online. This is all after Neuromancer, all of this after the beginning of Wired magazine, but it was meant to be an embodiment of the promise of the information superhighway. To give you an idea of how luxurious the Cybersmith was, there were employees to give tutorials on how to use different pieces of equipment and technology and load in software for you to try. You were paying to use the stations, but the whole feel was like a luxury ski resort or a spa, a beautiful hangout spot where you could try out the latest and the greatest. As more and more of this mid-1990s speculative graphic work and design comes online on the Internet Archive and elsewhere, I'm really taken aback at how flat it all seems to fall. Between the fact that the aesthetic was really designed to push the boundaries of what printing technology could do because screens could handle it better, and of course the breathless, endless tone of the old being thrown away and the new becoming the new reality, it gives off this weird stink that I didn't feel at the time. What I felt was excited and enthused, and a sense that things were not going to be the same. If you look at a lot of magazines of the 70s and 80s coming into the 90s, you are talking about black text on white background with squares of color to reflect illustrations. Outside of zine culture, you don't have images blasting into the margins and going into bizarre colors and color schemes that assault the eye and make you look at everything weirdly and try to decipher what's going on. It's a dynamic eyewash that's trying to make you look at the world differently and tell you that things are not going to be the same. It's all coded this way, and the Cybersmith had that feeling in real life that you were going to go into this interesting organic and digital world that reflected some sort of ideals of openness and freedom and thinking in areas that you never would have before, that was being born utterly anew. So it's neither a twist ending, nor I think a big surprise at all, that the Cybersmith went on for a number of years, lost a lot of money, and then ultimately went out of business. During one portion of its existence, it kind of scaled back all of this custom furniture and this custom look to become a kind of standard cafe with a lot of the technology pulled out. It was just a matter of running out its lease, selling coffee and energy drinks, and then quietly going out of business. I assume that family made the right financial decision, that they looked at the numbers, they realized it wasn't going to become a new chain, a nationwide event, and then they just quietly took it away, ran out the clock, and turned off the lights. Certainly as the 2000s came and the dot-com boom promised a world and sold a lot of people, a lot of pretty good machines with pretty good technology for making that last mile work, places like the Cybersmith didn't need to be luxury destinations. They could be a set of cubicles with a set of machines, patched-up versions of World of Warcraft to play on, or a simple web browser that got reset with every new user. The gold standard quickly became the lead standard, the lowest common denominator. But for a brief, shining moment in the glittery aftermath of the promises of the information superhighway, I'm glad that I got to walk through a living embodiment of the promises in a place that shouldn't have existed, in a bizarre set of rabbit warrens, an incredible future forever. This is Jason Scott, Talks His Way Out of It. Thanks to Mark Pilgrim, Forrest Fuqua, Scott McCrady, Scott Roseanne, James Bekoyanu, Simon Morgan, and the hundreds of other people on Patreon and elsewhere who have been supporting me and helping me get out of debt.